Today we are going to geek out a little bit about undersea internet cables, which are essentially the power of the internet running on the ocean floor. These cables are built and maintained by consortiums of internet companies usually. And last month, President Marcos himself led the launch of the Philippine Domestic Submarine Cable Network, touted as the longest and highest capacity submarine domestic fiber cable network that's supposed to power his Bagong Pilipinas. Joining us this morning to talk about the world of undersea cables is attorney Aileen Regio and Vince Stempong of Eastern Communications. Attorney Aileen, Vince, thank you so much for joining us. Good morning.
Good morning, and thank you very much, Mimi.
All right.
Thank you for having us.
Good morning to the viewers of Market Edge.
Thank you. So, Attorney Aileen, let's start with you. This $150 million, 2,500 kilometers undersea cable network is a joint project among InfiniVan, Globe Telecom, and Eastern Communications. Give us the background. Who is going to be using this infrastructure? What gaps does it address? And what's the capacity?
Well, thank you. That's correct. No, it is a joint project between Eastern Communications, Globe, and InfiniVan. It is purposely done so in order to not just bridge the digital divide, but also to improve the provision of telecommunications and internet services in the country. We want to be able to reach as much Filipinos as we can. That's reach. We want to be able to provide a resilient technology by having submarine cables instead of just fiber cables. Resilient because it's stronger, it's less susceptible to damages or breakage, and we want to be able to have a redundant network so that we don't experience an Odette-like outage where Cebu was isolated from the rest of the Philippines before. If you have submarine cable facilities, then if the land cables are down, you can reroute traffic via the subsea cables and you have continuous internet service. Therefore, communication is always up. Restoration of services, vital services, basic needs of the people will be easier, unlike what happened to us in the past. So we're very much excited for this project. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Mimi.
Just very quickly, you did say it's going to help telcos reach more Filipinos. So telco giants, you've got Globe, PLDT, Converge, will be using this infrastructure. They're the clients here.
Honestly, they can use the infrastructure. It's available for use by everyone, but primarily it will be used by the three parties. Then if we have excess capacity, we're always open to partnering. And that's the essence of democratization of the service, of the internet service in the country. And that's what we're aiming for, actually.
And what new areas would this cable unlock? Will this network unlock? You know, areas that were previously disconnected, now connected precisely because of this submarine cable network.
Yeah, several provinces will now be linked all the way from Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao via subsea cables. Other providers also link various parts of Luzon, Visayas, Mindanao, but these are through aerial or underground cable facilities. But as we know, this type of infrastructure are very prone to cable breaks, either by because of diggings, because of pilferage and theft, because of so many other reasons, typhoon, natural disasters. But with subsea cables, those concerns will not easily be encountered. So that's why we're excited with this project, because we know, unlike other types of facilities, it is not so prone to damages like that.
All right, Vince, I want to go to you. How do you think this domestic cable network can help in national connectivity, you know, this government's push for digitalization, especially during natural disasters? Attorney Aileen touched on this earlier, but any thoughts on it, if you can expound?
Okay. As mentioned by my partner, Attorney Aileen, the PDSCN, or this subsea cable, aims to connect the underserved and provide the much needed capacity in these key cities, which we've identified as key digital cities that require a lot of our bandwidth now. And we see that with fiber and the corresponding technology behind it, we would have enough capacity to fuel and to be the backbone of the digital transformation of these communities, including the private and public sectors, no? And the way we've designed the subsea cable is we've made it inherently resilient, no? In a sense that we have made and designed it such a way that we create rings that allow us to create multiple segments in case one of the segments goes down. The flow of the data transmission can move one way, clockwise or counterclockwise. That's one. And second is the way we've also worked it out with DNR is we found ways to minimize impact to our water resources, and two, as well as finding ways to ensure that in spite of being under the sea, our cables will still be safe from any natural or human event, no, that could cause catastrophic events or breakages to our subsea cable. Mm-hmm.
So this cable actually runs from where to where, Vince?
It actually runs from South Luzon all the way to Mindanao.
From Quezon to Zamboanga, correct?
That's correct. And the thing with this subsea cable is it has many links going up back to South Luzon, creating these loops and multiple routes, no, if you can call it that, no, to ensure that it is resilient and provides the connectivity required during a typhoon or any catastrophic event.
All right. Is it safe, though? I mean, Vince, you mentioned earlier whether it's natural or human events. There have been concerns raised globally, you know, about the safety of submarine cable networks, that they become even more vulnerable, Achilles heel, that could threaten global commerce, you know, even military readiness, they say, and internet itself, when certain parties and elements threaten undersea cables. What should we be doing about that? I was looking at some numbers, and I saw that globally, more than $10 trillion of financial transactions, commercial payments, trade transactions occur daily. And over 95% of the world's communications are carried by a network of cables laid across the oceans. So if you attack these cables in the oceans, it's going to stop the world on its track. How safe are these cable networks?
Yeah, you are right as far as the importance of these subsea cables. They do carry a lot of traffic and carry a lot of mission critical traffic. And a couple of things that we do is mainly one first is working with local authorities to ensure the safety, the physical safety of our cables. Two, as mentioned earlier, the way we've designed it, it is in a way that it is physically away from high traffic areas that could high traffic areas where we have a lot of traffic that could cause breakages to our subsea cable. And third, apart from physical security, we also ensure that the data transmission within these subsea cables are free from cyber attacks or whatnot, from hacking. Mm-hmm. Our cyber security solutions, no, that we've employed in our network and in our infrastructure.
This question I want to throw to either Vince or Attorney Aileen. If you could give us the lay of the land, though. I mean, this is not the only subsea cable network that involves the Philippines. There are international subsea cables that are connected to us, used by telco giants as well. Could you give us a sense what these are? Because for context, for example, Converge ICT has been working on their own networks, the Bifrost cable system and the Southeast Asia Hainan Hong Kong Express cable system. It's actually much bigger, 15,000 kilometers Bifrost project connecting the Philippines to Singapore, Indonesia, Guam, and the west coast of North America. What are some of these networks that surround and that link us up, aside from this domestic cable network?
Maybe I'll go first.
Go ahead.
By distinguishing what you mentioned, mm-hmm. Versus the PDSCN. The PDSCN is mostly domestic, so it links Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. Those other cable systems that you mentioned link the Philippines to other countries. So why did we do such a project, no? When we are also partners with other providers insofar as international cable systems are concerned. So the other international cable systems that you mentioned, we're also partners to that. Mm. But why did we do this? We did this because we want to be able to bridge the digital divide, as we mentioned earlier. Because in the Philippines, the predominant cable installation that we have are aerial and underground, that, as I said, is susceptible to breakage and damages. Whereas subsea cable facilities within the Philippines is not as susceptible. So I would like to distinguish, we start with distinguishing those types of cable facilities first. Vince, you may want to add?
Yes. Apart from what Attorney Eileen mentioned, no, given the geography of the Philippines, given that the many islands that we have in the country, no, it will be quite impossible for us to do terrestrial fiber. And the only economical and viable way to expand our coverage, no, to the South Luzon besides the Mindanao areas is through the subsea cable project. No? Mm-hmm. This project has both a subsea component and also a terrestrial component that allows us to distribute, no, our bandwidth and our capacity to the various cities in these islands that we are aiming to go to. Mm-hmm.
So this is essentially a distribution network. Do we have enough, though? Because if you think about it, why are the big players also investing in cable networks that connect us to other countries? Why do we need to be connected to Singapore, for example, or to Malaysia? For those who are non-tech.
Simply put, and in layman's term, when you try to access a site that is hosted, say, in Singapore, then you need your bandwidth need to travel from the Philippines to Singapore, and that is what those international cable systems are for. But of course, there are some. Well, I'd like to go into like caching and all. But if the data is not cached in the Philippines, your data, your traffic would have to go from the Philippines to Singapore, and you need the international cable systems. Mm. For domestic submarine cable network system, you will be able to, let's say, of course, we're at an archipelago. We have islands that are separated by bodies of water. You cannot build aerial cable from one island to another. Mm-hmm. You cannot build underground cable facilities from one island to another. Therefore, the solution in order to reach hard-to-reach and separated islands from one another is to subsea cable facilities.
All right.
So, each type of cable facility would have its own purpose.
Well, thank you for clarifying that. It's a very technical issue. So here's my final question, either to Vince or Attorney Eileen. You know, Eastern Communications is anything but small. You guys are big and you have a very long history. In fact, it's touted as the first communications service provider in the Philippines when Eastern Communications was commissioned by the Spanish government to provide the country's first telegraphic services. Quick question on the future. What kind of growth and expansion are you eyeing for this year? Are there more cable networks that you're working on? And any plans to tap the debt or capital markets for fundraising?
Let me ask.
Go ahead, Vince.
Any idea? One is for this year at least, though, we plan to focus on unlocking the opportunities that we have built through the PDSEN project. No? A lot of has to be done to operationalize and to monetize our investment in PDSEN. Though our expansion doesn't stop with PDSEN, we still look for opportunities to expand our reach, our network. No? Although maybe not as big as what we've done with PDSEN. No? We're looking at these digital cities that the ICT has identified, no, that will require a lot of capacity given the industries that they foresee that will be setting up shop in these locations. No. And apart from these connectivity expansion, no, we also will expand, no, our ICT portfolio, our services and products. No. Sometime in 2018, Eastern, no, decided to embark on a new journey, so to speak, no, by expanding our portfolio beyond connectivity and now includes ICT, no? Mainly focusing in the network solutions, cybersecurity solutions, data and cloud solutions, and even business application solutions. And we've seen that there was a lot of demand and pickup, no? As far as ICT is concerned, especially post-pandemic, no? Looking at our revenues, no? ICT has contributed to 60% of our new business as of 2023. And given this robust demand, no? We see that in ever-increasing demand, no? Of our customers, we see the need to look into new technologies, no? That could help companies to expand or deliver on their digital transformation. And we are also looking at new ways of working or new models, no? Such as managed services that could aid smaller enterprises, no? With their ICT requirements, because they may or may not have the capability to deliver on their digital transformation plans. And Eastern has the capability and will provide the capability and solutions, no, to these enterprises to help them with their digital transformation initiatives.
All right. And any plans to tap the debt or capital markets, Attorney Aileen?
Oh, definitely. It's a good source of revenue, and they really need a robust and reliable internet connectivity. If I may just go back to, thank you for that research. We're 145 years old. We have a lot of plans. We've always had the notion, we've always had plans to in continuously improving our network, because we know that it's really our network that we are selling, and it's really our network where we embark on all our products we use for our plans and programs. And we'd like to be able to be at the forefront in the minds of our clients as their partner in progress whenever they think of going into new businesses, digital transformation, and whatnot.
All right.
So that's plans of Eastern.
Are any plans to list at the Philippine Stock Exchange, perhaps?
Why not? Maybe in the future.
All right. On that note, Attorney Aileen, Vince, always a pleasure talking about these tech stuff with the experts. Thank you so much for, you know, clarifying what's been very difficult to wrap our minds around, because all of these talk about clouds and sea cable networks. Now we understand it a little bit more. Thank you again for the time and the insights. We'll see you soon. Congratulations on the new cable
network. Thank you, Mimi.
All right.